try out life in a 9,000-year-old city.
Helen, I think we should get out, mate.
And not only that, but I'll be having an exclusive chat to Harry Potter star Ginny Weasley.
First of all, let's introduce them to Andy's new toy.
Yeah, it's so big that it can't even fit into the studio, so I'm gonna have to call him. Right, let's go. I'm gonna use this megaphone here. Andy! It's massive, but where's the rest of it? Did you lose it?
Well, usually I've been driving a truck with a trailer, but this is actually a racing truck. And the reason I've got this here is because my new challenge involves me taking part in a truck race that looks a little bit like this. Stop!
That looks pretty scary, Andy. I mean, are you gonna be all right?
Well, like, the thing is, at the moment, I'm learning to drive a truck with a trailer, and that's how I'm going to pass normally.
Okay.
But I'm going to have to learn to drive this in order to do that race. And I've had a few lessons so far. Let's just say I was feeling a little bit dodgy.
Now,
facial expressions.
It makes me feel physically sick watching it. It's just like that. I know how you feel basically. So this weekend, what's planned?
Well, I need to get more race time. I need to get more track time actually, so I know how to take the bends and stuff. But the thing about this is that it pulls the equivalent of 1,000 horses. That's how much power this has. And this can actually accelerate a Ferrari. And it's 3 times faster than a regular truck as well. So I've got a beast to deal with, you know what I mean?
You'll be fine. I've got every faith in you, but I might stay up the road this weekend. Don't be mean. Right, it's time now for more from our summer road trip across Turkey. And for the next instalment, we head into Asia, where we made some amazing discoveries.
Right, let's go.
Put your belt on.
We're journeying from Europe to Asia on a road trip through Turkey, a country with some of the most amazing ancient ruins on Earth.
But on today's adventure, we'll be travelling back in time and finding out just how lucky we are not to live in the Stone Age.
It's really smoky in there.
Our first stop is Ephesus, on the Aegean coast, once the capital of Asia.
If you want to know what life was like 2,000 years ago when the ancient Greeks and Romans were in their prime, this is one of the best places in the world to visit. Most of the ruins that are still standing today are from the Roman period. Among them, there's this, a massive amphitheatre that held huge events like gladiator fights. Now, this would have held about 25,000 spectators. That's bigger than some of the UK's biggest concert venues like the O2 Arena in London. And that was built 2,000 years later. But for me, here's something they didn't get quite right. This, a public toilet block. Has anybody got any loo roll? Anybody? Yeah, this place is pretty ancient, but it's not as old as the place we're about to go to. It's 9,000 years old, and the best thing about it is it's still being discovered. Leaving Ephesus, we travelled to a place called Çatalhöyük in the heart of Turkey, where 50 years ago, archaeologists stumbled across something amazing.
On a hillside, they unearthed the remains of a massive 9,000-year-old site.
Welcome to one of the oldest cities on Earth.
That is it.
It looks like a spaceship, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Çatalhöyük is one of the most exciting archaeological digs in the world. 250 archaeologists, many of them British, have spent the last 16 years painstakingly looking for clues to help them piece together a picture of what life was like in this ancient city.
And they've reached house number 80. No one knows what secrets could lie within these remains. It's time for Blue Peter to find out.
Look at that.
Look at that. That's a city. It's a 9,000-year-old city.
There's a lot of it, considering how old it is. Mm. Like the walls and stuff.
Where do you reckon the local kebab shop was?
Right there.
Well, if we were going to find out the answer to this, we needed to do some detective work. It's thought that House 80 burned down and was used as a rubbish dump, so we had to sort through it.
Doing the bins.
Mate, rubbish men.
9,000-year-old garbage is actually gold dust to archaeologists. Finding out what people threw away tells you lots about how they lived, but you have to know what you're looking for.
How do you know what's actually an artefact and what's just, like, rubbish like that?
Well,
is that an artifact? I found something?
Yeah, it's a tiny little bit of bone.
I just found some bone! Of who? Of what, do you think? Animal?
It's too small to identify that, I'm afraid.
It's my first archaeological find. I'm gonna get better now.
All right, show off. I found some bone too.
I can't believe I've broken it. Knowing my luck, this will turn out to be the most important bone here.
8,000 to 9,000 years ago is called the Neolithic period, which came at the end of the Stone Age. It was a time of great change in the way humans lived. Instead of wandering around alone hunting and gathering food, humans started to live together in groups, building houses, making tools and farming. Some of the most amazing discoveries at Chatahoyuk wouldn't look out of place today. These 9,000-year-old clay figures are prehistoric art. They're giving archaeologists clues about life here and the sorts of animals that were around at the time.
I think that looks like an aardvark or an anteater or something. He's got a big nose. I'm not sure if you had them around here at that time. I'm going to turn her around. That's a bit rude, bless her. And I still maintain that that's a Scotty dog.
One of my finds was a piece of glass-like black volcanic rock called obsidian. Fragments of obsidian have been found all over the site, and it seems to have had lots of different uses at Chatahoyuk.
These are arrowheads. This would have been used, we mainly think, for hunting. These are razor sharp blades, and I mean that. When this stuff is freshly worked, it's sharper than surgical steel. It's the main raw material they're using. Don't forget, not only is this before they've invented the wheel, it's before we've got metal working. So obsidian is what everybody's using in their household. Imagine a sack full of this stuff being dragged back on your back for a couple of days over 180 miles. That's a lot of work.
They're impressive people, aren't they?
I was discovering something quite chilling about life and death in this city. This is a bone store, and each one of these crates is full of human bones. The reason there's so many bones here is because the people of Chatahoyuk buried their dead underneath their houses.
Freaky.
The archaeologists have pieced together some clues about life here 9,000 years ago, but there are still a lot of things they want to find out.
They've built a replica of what they think house number 80 would have been like, and they asked us to test it out. We would be the first people ever to cook a Neolithic meal and spend the night here.
This is nice.
Yeah, quite
mosquitoes. Really nice. We've got loads of food, nuts, spices, chilies and beans.
The archaeologists think the entrance was through the roof and that the houses didn't have windows. They suggested we put up a chimney to stop our house filling up with smoke when we burnt our fuel. Poo.
That's the fuel for our fire.
It's like smoke poo.
Dunk, it is poo. Seeing as you've got accustomed with it, just get your hands in and shove some in the fire.
This is great, right? So you know how to do the fire and I'm doing all the...
Let's talk more speed. Oh, it stinks.
I'm going for the pistachios. Ground on toast. No, just...
No,
sorry, there's the pistachios roasted with herbs.
No, yeah, we could do that.
Andy, your help is minimal. You're lying on a bed.
I'm thinking of something creative to make. We can make that pistachio and herbs thing. That sounds quite cool.
Now we can use that one modern item, the match.
Oh, I'm hoping that this man-made chimney works.
We need a bit more oxygen in it, don't we? Oh, welcome back. If we had a newspaper, this would be so much easier.
What about if I sort of, like, go like that?
No, you don't.
Oh, I didn't do that, that was Andy.
Oh, come on, whatever.
If they can do it 9,000 years ago, we've got the internet. We should be able to do it.
This isn't looking good, is it? You're doing well, Helen, though.
Well, thanks for your help, Joel.
You just have pistachio nuts of herbs and not cook anything. Are you using our rug? To light the fire?
Yeah, kind of got no option really.
Should we try the cheap sheepskin as well?
The thing is now to keep these burning because we're running out of matches.
Guys, when I don't eat, I get weak. When I get weak, I get tired.
Does that mean you get quiet?
No.
It took long enough and I was ravenous, but finally we had it lit.
Wow. Brilliant, look, you've got fire.
Hang on, let's high five it.
Let's all put it in. No, I wouldn't do that any other time. Do this. Oh no, more touches. Should I go and hunter gatherer? Shall I be a hunter gatherer? You get some twigs.
Do it.
Okay.
Bring back a pizza.
Shall I break up the pistachios, see if we can get a few nuts wearing? Got a few herbs here. Whack him in. See what goes on.
But all that was going on was a shed load of smoke. It was all starting to go horribly wrong.
Helen, I think we should get out, babe. Helen, come on.
Run.
It's really smoky in there.
Mate.
We put the chimney in, though, didn't we?
Why is it not coming out the chimney but somewhere else?
Oh, it's so smoky. Killer.
With our experiment not even lasting the night, we clearly weren't up to Neolithic standards. The mystery of how they lived their lives 9,000 years ago is still unsolved.
What are we going to do?
Well, there is one other option.
No, I don't...
I got the floor. Our 1970s camper van and all its mod cons had suddenly become the most comfortable place in the world.
So much better.
Next time on our Turkish adventure, we lift off in the land of the fairy chimneys.
Wow, what an experience. Like, you and that fire, so persistent. She really let it go.
It was frustrating, though. I just wanted to get it working. It was just a bit smoky in the end, wasn't it?
Very true.
I thought we'd left these outfits in Turkey.
Every time. Just can't let it go.
It's too rad. This is radness. If you look up the dictionary, radness, this should be in it. Now, if you want to be part of our Turkish adventure, why not play the Turkish Bazaar? Yeah. It's a game on the Blue Peter website. It's really fun. I'm really good at it, just died. Also, if you want to walk the dog, there's a game which is called Pup World, where you get to walk Barney trying to avoid things.
Hey, we've had loads of messages on the message boards about Barney. Computerized Sunshine says, I love dogs, mostly the ones on Blue Peter. That's very kind. And they haven't seen Barney yet, but are looking forward to seeing him.
We've got another one here from Fab Emma Bob. Nice name. I love Barney. He's the cutest dog I've ever seen. I hope he gets over the travel sickness. I've grown out of travel sickness now. Hope he does too. Me too, man. It stinks.
Well, let me know. Yeah, it's my car. Let me know what you did to get over travel sickness, because I could do the tips. Now, I know I'm kind of going on about the dog a bit much. Everybody's sick of me shoving pictures of Barney in their face, but I've got one more thing to show you. It's a nodding Barney. How cute is he? Right, I'm going to show you how to make these. You don't have to make Barney. You could make Lucy or Mabel. I know Mabel's pink there, but we gave her a bit of a makeover. Now, it is pretty simple to do, but you'll need quite a few things. All of these bits and bobs, but don't worry if you haven't got time to write them all down now. Everything is on the website. To make the dog's body, first up, you need a plastic bottle. So just take it like that, obviously when you've finished drinking it, of course, and then paper mache it to build up the body. So if you want to do paper mache, all you do, get some runny glue, slap it on like that, tear up a load of old newspaper and stick it on. And you just keep going all the way around the body and building it up until you've got, well, a curvy dog if you want a curvy dog, a skinny dog if you want a skinny dog. And we're going to use the same technique to make the dog's legs. But first up, take some scrap newspaper and make 4 chicken drumstick shapes. 2 fat ones like that and 2 skinny ones like that. When you've paper mache the body, you'll end up something like that. And I've built up the legs so they're a bit smoother and they look a bit more dog-like. And all I did was use the same technique, plenty of glue on there, slap it all on. It doesn't matter if it's messy because you're gonna paint over all of this. So nobody's gonna see the scraps of newspaper. Just keep smoothing it on like that until they look like they are attached to his body, like proper legs. Right, I'm gonna move all this out of the way because that takes quite a while and you need a bit of patience. Put newspaper down, otherwise you'll make a real mess on your mum or dad's kitchen table. Now, to do the head, you can either use a plastic ball or you can use the top of the washing liquid that you use to wash your clothes, because that's got a hole in it already, but I've cut a hole in the bottom of that one.
cover it using the same technique, paper mache all the way over till it's nice and smooth, and use a scrunched up bit of newspaper to make his nose. Once again, I've just paper mache that all on so you can't see the join. To make the ears, just take a bit of card, cut out an ear shape like that, stick it onto the side using a bit of sticky tape. Now, it doesn't matter if it looks messy because you're gonna paper mache over that as well, just so that it's all easier to paint and it looks properly joined on. Right, let all the paper mache in dry overnight because it takes a while. And once it's dry, you can paint the whole thing white. Now, if you paint it white, it's gonna be easier to decorate a bit later on. I am going to make this one brown, so it looks a bit more like Barney. Now, just cover the whole thing, the head and everything, and at this point, you can decorate the head as well. So I'm gonna put a couple of eyes on this one. I'm not gonna stick them on now because I've finished painting. You can put eyes on, you can make a nice little collar using some ribbon, so that can go around here. You can do whatever you like, really. We've gone a bit crazy with colors on some of the other ones. I want this one to look like Barney. So once you have decorated him, it should look something like this. And then it's time to get clever. You need to make the pendulum so that you can ensure your dog nods. Take a straw, and then about 2 fingers from the top of the straw, pierce a hole through it using a cocktail stick, like that. Then you need the end to be heavy. So I've used some nuts and bolts and just tape them to the bottom so that it swings like this, right? Then put that inside the body so that the cocktail stick holds it on the top. Right, inside the head, you need to make a little device so that that straw fits in nicely. If you get some foam and cut out 4 circles like that, stick them together using a bit of sticky tape and pierce a hole right through the middle so that your straw will sit on there nicely and stick it inside his head. Then what you need to do is thread that on nice and carefully. And when you balance it just right, it will look like this little fellow here. So that's a finished nodding Barney. And as I said, you don't have to make Barney. You could make Lucy. Lucy is looking really, really yellow there. I don't know what she's been eating.
Lemons.
Does that make it yellow? We've done Mabel pink. What's she eating?
Plums.
Socks and cookie, plums are purple. And if you're not a pet person, you can make a nodding person.
Look! Is that me?
It's a nodding Joel.
Let's have a look, ready? Let's see if it looks like me.
It's definitely quieter than you.
Because it can't speak. Hold on, that's very good. Now, so which one's socks and cookie?
Socks and cookie.
Right, that's good, because that leads me on to my next piece of information. Now, there's a cat show. Right, and if you think your cat is beautiful, why not enter it into the Blue Peter Cat category? It closes on the 26th of October. Check out the details on the website. And also, while you're there, why not have a look at the Me and My Movie stuff? Because there's still time to get your 2-minute film in. Who knows, you could have an award-winning cat and an award-winning film. What an amazing piece
that
of...
would be.
Yeah, and also what chatter to have at the playground. Now, talking of films, I got some last-minute tips of a member of the Harry Potter cast. If you haven't started your 2-minute movie yet and you want to add some magic, well, I've got some top tips from a top star.
That'll be Bonnie Wright, who plays Ginny Weasley in Harry Potter.
Take my hand.
Bonnie is currently making the last 2 Harry Potter films, and she's taken a couple of hours out of her hectic schedule to talk to us.
How's the new film going?
Yeah, really well. We're kind of midway through shooting at the moment, so it's all going very well. And the last one's really exciting. It's going to be a big, epic, dramatic story.
Bonnie's first tip, a good story.
The first step you really take is to begin to write the story. You could really go for sort of really melodramatic, sort of fantasy film, or you could go for something much more kind of calmer, more like romance thing or thriller.
So once you've got your story straight, time to get shooting. Bonnie's next tip, some fun camera tricks. Close-ups add loads of tension, and Bonnie is going to show us how.
I was thinking we could do like a dramatic sort of stare-off shot.
Ready?
Cutting close-ups together can increase tension of a scene. Oh, who's going to blink? I blink first.
Another thing you could do to really kind of throw it all off and make a really dramatic, unexpected scene is we could do a kind of earthquake shake.
Okay.
Yeah, ready?
Yeah, ready? Shaking the camera.
When do we start?
You could do a low shot to make you look really powerful and strong. A high shot to make you look kind of really small and timid.
OK, time for a break. So I have to ask, what was it like to kiss Harry Potter?
Yeah, it was quite strange, really. I guess we've known each other now for so long, and kind of, I think when you are kind of doing a scene that's much more intimate than other ones you've been doing, you kind of have to sort of forget about everything that's around you, you know. But, you know, it wasn't actually too difficult. It was fine.
And that brings us to our final tip. Sound effects.
OK, so now what would you do? So you just get the sound and put it next to the microphone?
Yeah, you could kind of use the actual microphone of the camera to sort of kind of, you know, you could rustle on it or sort of blow onto it.
So this is cornflakes?
Yeah, so I'm going to record it sort of with the microphone on the camera. If you kind of rustle with it, it does sound kind of quite similar to kind of rustling leaves if you're walking down the street.
OK, ready? Let's record this. I mean, you could just kick leaves, but I get you. OK, now the next one.
Yeah.
Is sticky tape.
Yeah, and also if you just crackle it kind of really gently and imagine sort of an open burning fire, sort of those nice embers all burning away.
Now that is good. Okay, and finally.
Yeah, this one's quite a tricky one, but it's good fun.
Right, what shall I do here?
Okay, so if you blow into the water mm-hmm. to make some sort of gentle bubbles.
That sounds just like a mad professor's laboratory.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
For all your tips. I hope you're getting involved, because Dan and Jeff are, now you've already been on the show last week, helping us break a world record for mattress dominance.
Wasn't that brilliant?
I'm a world record holder. I can't believe it.
Yeah, he hasn't stopped telling everybody we meet.
But your hat was quite special.
Did you
can't
like
forget
the pink
that.
Bonnet? Did you like that?
Very good. Well, you guys have been busy making your own movies for our Me and My Movie competition. Obviously too old, but here's one of them. It's called Dan Man. Take a look.
Once I activate my Mega Ultra Jeff Ray, I will turn the whole planet into a world of Jeffs!
Only Dan Man could save me now!
Dan Man!
Dan Man, I knew you'd come!
Epic, lads.
That is
absolutely
huge.
Epic.
Yeah.
On nationwide release soon.
Yeah.
Hollywood's knocking on our door.
That is fantastic.
Millions in
well,
that.
We've got a message here from the message board from and lovely Kim77. She says, the movies they make are so funny. If you need any more people to tell you how funny that
wow,
is.
Wow, thank you. I like that.
Excellent.
Who is that? Kim.
Yeah, Kim.
Thank you, Kim.
Have a word.
What are your tips? What's your idea? Give us your advice, even. That's what I'm looking for. What's your advice for making good films?
I think just make sure you remember what you've done in the shot before, because there's nothing more embarrassing than wearing a different shirt from one shot to the other, which we've managed.
Yeah, we have
managed that.
Oh, and use a tripod, because balancing the camera, it tends to fall over. And when you borrow the camera from the BBC, they don't like it.
Good work. Okay, one final message from Scantin Emily 09. She says she loved The Illustrated Man, which is another one of your films, and it was so funny, her sister fell off her chair. Lads. Hilarity.
Wow. Thank you, Emily.
What a strange question, though. More of a statement.
Stairs.
Yes. So, if you want any more details about Me and My Movie, go to bbc.co.uk/Me and My Movie. And the closing date is the 5th of October. Thank you very much, Dan and Jeff.
Thank you.
Helen.
Barney and I have been going through some of your letters. This is Toby, who is 6¾ years old. He lives in Fife and he's been out and about collecting litter. Do let us know what you've been up to. You might earn yourself a Blue Peter badge like this.
Yeah, good work, mate. But join us next week where I'll be breakdancing a BMX.
And we'll be launching our brand new Doctor Who competition. Trust me, it's big.
Bye-bye.
They're about to be beaked like they've never been beaked before.
It's typical. You really want to see your favourite TV show, but the sun's shining, your mates are playing outside, and you'd love an ice cream. Well, now there's a way to enjoy the summer and still see all your favourite telly. Go to our website and click on CBBC iPlayer. You'll find all the CBBC shows from the last 7 days right there on your computer. That way, you can watch the things you love when you want. CBBC iPlayer puts you in control.
Ah!